HarperCollins presents The Boy in the Park by A J Grayson, read by William Hope. The Boy in the Park, Stanza 1. Little boy in the park, little boy standing lost. The water's quiet, the tree wings dance for the little boy still unmoving. The little boy with stick in hand. Little boy weeping, little boy weeping. I am not certain I may ever know, ever understand that which makes death what it is, and sorrow so sadly, desperately haunting. I am not sure what it is that lingers once everything else is gone. But I know the boy, alive through all his torments, and perhaps that is enough. Perhaps we are not meant to know anything more cosmic than one child, one face, one set of hands. In them, I have found enough grief to encompass the whole of creation. Dr. Pauline Lavrentis, Interview Notes. Part 1. San Francisco. Chapter 1. Tuesday. My bench in the park is old, tainted from moisture, tinged a faint green by the growth of a moss that will one day consume it. A brass plaque that was once a color other than tarnished black notes that it is dedicated to the memory of Margaret Haas, beloved, 1924 to 2008. Margaret's bench, now mine. We sit together beneath the trees. We sit. And we watch, and the world dances before us. From Margaret's bench, I am afforded the best view in the park. It is not off one of the great grassy quadrangles, nor the main paved walkways that crisscross the gardens. To find it requires taking one of the thousand dirt pathways that branch away from these, spidering into densely planted greenery that's divided, for convenience, by continent of origin. My bench is in the hidden underbrush of temperate Asia, and all around it are plants with names like Autumn Joy, Nymphia fabiola, Emerald Cypress, and Primrose Willow. The bench itself sits on a patch of wood chips, a place to rest one's feet in the absence of mud, a private retreat. And descending below, spreading out beyond my toes, is the pond. The pond is tranquil, even beautiful. Not the blue-basined, sanitized sort of water feature too common in public spaces. There's one of those in the park, too, at the center of its most obvious green lawn. The pond, though entirely man-made, is of a style au naturel. Just the right number of lily pads and watercress color its surface. A few stones peek up from the brown water, often serving as purchase for birds or even the occasional turtle. Surrounded by tall leafy trees, the pond is generally hidden from the breeze, and so almost always the texture of glass, and just as reflective. I sit on my bench, the poet in the midst of poetry. It is an everyday thing, or almost every day, this visit. I come with my little moleskin notebook and stubby pencil, sometimes with a paper cup dredging coffee beneath a plastic lid marked with the brown imprints of my lips. And I, the poet, gaze into paradise. Outside the park, so close by, looms the paved wasteland of the city. I can hear it as I sit, there, out of sight. Cars, petrol, hybrid, or electric, it makes no difference, really. Skyscrapers, slums. But here, here, a poet can come to sing his song to the greens and browns of nature and witness its singing back. A couple strolls by, arms linked at the elbows, smiling, a Nikon camera dangling from the man's neck. There is a punctuated look in the woman's eyes. Romance, keyed in by the scents of begonias and rhododendrons. It's become a visible flush of redness on her face. I can tell she hopes it will become something more. A chipmunk descends from a tree marked by a small plastic sign as Picea orientalis, oriental spruce. He observes the layout before him, the inclines and dips of the soil. There is food here, a treasure trove of it. He seems fairly confident. A tail shivers in anticipation. Nearby, a bird, a hermit thrush, I'm almost certain, swoops down and takes a perch on one of the rocks jutting up from the water. The breath from his wings ripples the surface, changing a still mirror into one of undulating motion. There is a poem here. I can feel it. Woven into the greenery, the humanity, the natural ebb and flow of life. A poem waiting to be found, waiting to be spoken. One that will sing of something brighter than the dark world that gives it birth. And then, there in the distance, I catch it. The little brush of motion from the branches, customary and expected. I turn my head slightly, but I know what's there. I've known since before the motion came. It's familiar now, this sight, seen on 18 months of afternoons just like this. The little boy emerges from the boughs of the faux Asian foliage. He takes 3 steps to the edge of the man-made pond's crafted waterline, to where his toes almost touch. He wears the same worn overalls, the same once white t-shirt beneath them that I've seen him wear more times than I can remember. His blonde hair is disheveled, as all little boys should be. He holds a stick in his right hand and pokes it listlessly at the water's edge, sending new ripples across the pond. He gazes vacantly out at these results of his movements. The jade treetops bend in a breeze that doesn't descend to the tops of our scalps. The boy is mesmerized. I am mesmerized. The bird on the rock clucks from somewhere beneath its beak, then flaps its wings to take flight. The little boy doesn't notice. His gaze is still on the ripples of the water, meeting other ripples, colliding gently in the swell of a scene fabricated by man, yet hauntingly serene. Almost inhuman. Almost free. And I cannot quite see his eyes. Chapter 2. Wednesday morning. There is a rail workers' strike today. It's the third this year, and I feel as a result as if I'm becoming an old hand at dealing with them. Taking the train normally saves me 30 minutes of traffic and $28 in a day's parking charges, but a bus still beats out the car for second best. No reprieve from the traffic, but it's a $2.50 ride, and there's a stop by the shop where I work, so I can hardly complain. It's meant a morning on a hard plastic bench seat rather than a padded one, and a bit more jostling of starts and stops than my generally impatient personality would prefer. But the wheels on the bus have gone round and round, and I'm fairly certain I'll get from point A to point B alive and unscathed. I'd live closer to work if I could, the traditional commuter's lament. There's nothing in particular to recommend Diamond Heights, the neighborhood south of the city that I call home, apart from the fact that it's outside central San Francisco proper and, therefore, the grossly overinflated San Francisco housing market. The Planning and Urban Research Association designed the district as part of the Community Redevelopment Law of 1951, transforming most of its shanties into livable quarters, one of which I call my own. On a rental basis, of course. To be honest, I can't really afford living there either, but it's a full 3 or 4 degrees less unaffordable than even the smallest flat in the city would be, and those are the kinds of math that make the impossible seem feasible these days. So it's home, and it has the glamour of having diamonds in its name. I can't say I entirely mind the commute. As the sun rises over the hills in the morning, its rays bouncing up off the sea, San Francisco's not a bad city to look at. I don't know if it's the beauty of the bay on its inland side, with its islands and hills and bridges, or the mystery of the endless, borderless ocean stretching out on the other. But something gives this city an aura, an otherness I've never felt replicated anywhere else. A sliver of land wholly encapsulated by the natural world, as if the earth herself had drawn a line around the silicon and steel and said, "This far you may come, you may make your homes and monuments, this far, but no further." The bus rounds a corner, swerving its metal bulk to avoid a tiny parked Nissan, and pulls onto Lincoln Way. I've taken this line before, I know the route, but even so my heart flutters ever so slightly. It flutters because Lincoln brings us alongside my haven. Dylan Aronson's perfect heaven, the place I most love. There, on our left, is the park. Somewhere in there, my little pond, my little bench. It will be a while until I can visit them, can retreat beneath those trees away from all this noise. There's still the morning's work ahead. But just the sight is soothing. I suppose I'm an easy person to soothe. I wonder for a moment if everyone is like that, where merely the sight of something loved makes the demons run away and peace descend a little closer to the present. Apart from the modified commute, this morning has been ritualistically predictable, both before and after. In some sense, there's little to say of such a start to a day. As one who's never fully cottoned on to the social media trend, I find myself unexercised in articulating the vacuously ordinary and unremarkable, in sharing something as mundane as the fact that I chose brown socks today rather than black, that I bit my cheek while brushing my teeth. It's simply been the routine. Coffee? Perhaps, definitely, too much. 2 eggs, a scan over the emails that accrued during the night, mostly advertising and spam and announcements of new digital titles we're sure you're going to enjoy, though the whole phenomenon of digital books generally eludes me. Then the commute. Then work, such as it is, with its customary temptations and boredom-inducing normalities. It's hard to look at the day-to-day flow of a life and not conclude that the vast majority of it is wasted, cycling through conversations that have been had before, actions that have been done before, chasing goals that never provide the sense of completion they promise. It was that kind of morning, the expected kind. I have no status that allows me to escape the dross of life through rank. I'm not the sort that can claim a renowned profession or a compelling job title, so mornings generally lead organically into the mundane of the day. And I don't particularly mind this. It's neither as exciting as it could be, nor as boring. I'm satisfied to reside in the middle. There is one definitive job perk, though, and that's my midday schedule. An extensive lunch break is one of the benefits of menial employment, and there's little more menial than being a teller at a health food retail shop selling vitamin capsules to yuppies whose only question is some repetitive variant on, "Is this the organic version? I really want the organic version." I've been gainfully employed at Sunset Health Supplements for 2 years, and despite the persistent desire to toss our vapid customers off the nearest bridge, and we have a few good ones for that here in the city, I have to admit that not once have I been denied an ample midday escape. One that gives time to walk down the bustling rush of 7th Avenue to Golden Gate Park, then the twisting bends of Martin Luther King Jr. Drive to the iron gates mounted under pine-green signage that reads, "San Francisco Botanical Gardens." 2 layers of fencing and turnstiles, fortress-like, as if the plants inside required prison-level security to preserve them from the outside world. Today, at 12:11 p.m., I walked through those gates, produced my local ID so as to avoid the tourist's entrance fee, and wandered through the greenery to my bench. To that spot where that which is expected is also that which is cherished. I took my familiar steps and thanked God it's not just the dreary parts of life that are repetitive. I have no coffee today here on my perch. Enough of it has already worked its way into my system. It often does on mornings like this, which, though unremarkable, follow restless nights. I have too many of those, though there's no discernible reason why I should. My job isn't exactly the high-stress sort, and outside of work, all is generally as peaceful as I could hope for. But still, sleep is often slow in coming, and there doesn't seem to be anything I can do about it. I've tried the tablets, descended at times to drink, even given a shot to the soothing tones of a new-age sure sleep app downloaded to my phone for 99 cents. But nothing really helps. An apple won't refund the 99 cents. Insomnia is like an unwanted family member on a holiday visit. The more you wish he would leave, the more obstinately he remains. So, no coffee, but I have my notebook and my pencil, the productive equipment, and the food and the drink of the poet, which is what I consider myself and what I am, despite the fact of my rather more worldly employment. And the absence of a single published poem. A badge of honor, I'm convinced. True poets never publish. To publish a poem is to sell one's soul, to befoul and dirty one's words with consumerism and industrial approval-seeking. This is a realization almost all real poets come to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.